you're stuck with me. I guess I'm a little lonely. I kind of like, I see all these, actually these guys are outside and on the front porch here, and they're having lively conversation. I'm like, I remember lively conversation. I remember that. But that's all right. Oh, sorry, shaking my desk here. Anyway, I have you. I have you to keep me company. Interwebs. I know these are strange times, right? The pandemic ostensibly is over. But... I don't know. You know, I could do this kind of thing, too. Wonder if that'll work. Movement, yeah, actually. Do that. Interesting. So if I had Y and I had an X, oh, I see, it does X, Y, and then it does Z. Up here, if I did it up here, I would do... I'm sorry, I'm doing, making weird sounds. Listen to my wonderful new voice. I'm obviously in a weird mood tonight, for sure. So here I would just do repeat num axes, you know, right there, like that. That would be the end of that. Boom. And I will keep the braces on here, that's important. Repeat doesn't do anything special for you like this. That would be nice if it did. But no, it does not. I could wrap it like that. But my friends knew. I will be doing it this way instead. No, my friends. Yeah, that's how we do that. How about that? So, yeah. That may seem like it's really oblique now. Can't even see that there's an axis being manipulated here in any way whatsoever. Don't be fooled. I'm going to call it, let's see, free XY. Oh, I see, yeah. Oh, yeah, okay, yeah, okay, never mind that. What I need here is a form of max that actually is max, like, I wonder if that'll work. Can I just say, I feel like that's not gonna work because like sometimes max is a function and not a macro. And also it's usually a ternary. Where am I at? I want a version of max that is like completely, like this should be 2 or 1. But, yeah, I guess what I'll go for here is this. Yeah, let's undo for a second. Yeah, see, it's what happens. You gotta look at it before you realize, oh, if I put that up there, that means it's gonna have code for both this and, again, all of them plus that, maybe. I mean, maybe the compiler again would see, oh, these are 2 invariant blocks, and just realize it only needs to put in 1 of them. But, you know, can you trust that? I mean, I feel like I have to guide it. So I'm just going to say undo and then put these back in. And you see, instead of this, you just simply say sub move, and yeah, allow there to be an extra semicolon. X-axis, I guess, or X. Then same here, Y. Y. You can even do that. You can say, yeah, turn. Sure. Then for the rest of the time, you do the 2. With a delta, you definitely know X, Y. These, you know, you got those. Sub 2, actually, the cool thing here is if it goes below 0, it stays at 0. 0, sub 2 is 0. So, or so I should say, sub 2, 0, it is 0. Okay. That's all I needed right there. Just wanted to kind of build these all around the same row. Okay. Move submenu for each axis, believe it or not. Yeah, this meant you have to have move XY. And the others are free XY, and then the others are those. And if I was to do a loop, actually, that's interesting, because if I was to do a loop, that would also be permissible. Have I done this before? Apparently not. Have I done this before? Oh yeah, also, yeah. Well, it's got that going for it. I don't know, it's so much neater, right? But I could just certainly do a loop here, because actually the loop would be smaller. So just that's just what's fair. Let me see. If loop is less than If loop is less than, let's talk about this. If num axes, right, greater than, say, if has j axis, I axis, sorry, then we do our loop. And we just do for, A equals I axis. A less than num axes. A plus plus. Hey, and then you just do boom. A. There. That's better than repeat, which basically just, you know, loop. Nice little loop. And it's clean. So then again, we can just repeat, put these back where they Which I guess is neater in the general overall. Oh, and yeah. Hello? Y-axis? Yes. That's what I meant. Okay. If has X, Y, Z, I, J, K, U, V, W. Gotcha. Okay, feeling better about that. X, Y. Oh, I kind of want to do a loop here. No. Must not do loop. Must not do loop. Right. I don't have a last axis at the moment. Or do I? Or should I just go A is less than... Oh wait, of course, I don't want to go all the way to num axes. Yeah, give me the smaller one here. Num axes minus 1 is X axis, then we're all good. Okay, so I'm going to do this. I gotta look at this thing here where I'm comparing things because I feel like, why should I not be able to do this, you know? Yeah, I'm seeing it doesn't matter. Making a big deal out of nothing here with all this casting nonsense here. Should be fine. We should be okay here. Yeah, it just gives us this. So it's just, you know, again, it's going to be invariant. It'll generate one line of code. It's the same. Go away. Yes, I'm happy. How else can I just prove it to you? I'm happy. Got kind of night. Second night, folks. We're at.
Be happy, happy.
Okay. Oh, you know, they're probably tripping. That's why they're up so late. 2:42. And also chatty, or maybe that's cocaine. I don't know what they're doing. Those kids out there. I don't know what kind of wacky stuff they're into. Oh, I guess I'm starting with Z here, huh? Forgot to start with Z. Oops. So less than equal to one of these things, and we make it go plus if two. Finally, the other thing about it. All right, Z. Can't believe straight to I and didn't think of poor Z. Loop. There's a loop. Okay, I guess after the merge, you have to live with it. Could always go back. I'd do that. I use git ref log. I'm hip. That stuff. Look, I made those comments look so much better. I indented some things that needed love. They weren't indented before either. So, cool, I fixed that. Probably the same, probably my fault. Let's see, that's prettier, slightly. Okay. Oh, I haven't refreshed to look at my lovely loops yet. Yeah, look at that. That made me so mad to look at that just now. Just realizing how hideous it was. Yeah, look at how it's all gone. All gone. I want to say less than Z or numax, but this seems wrong. Because what would it be? It would be, yeah, no, that actually makes sense if I just do it that way. I see, you can see why I did it this way. It's more expressive. So maybe I should leave it like that. Maybe. I don't know, it's smaller. It's smaller this way. Oh, okay. Less than or equal is generally better when you get a loop. Just know what it means, exactly what it means. Less than, it's always a little like, why less than Z? It don't like a Z? It'll be interesting to see, though, if it knows, if it's smart enough, this whole thing, if it notices that. Nah, I guess it won't. Well, no, there's a case where if it's delta, it'll be, or if it's not delta, right. If it's not delta, this will always be there. So what happens is that this part never gets compiled. And then, right, not delta, falls down to here. It'll see, oh, it's continuing this loop from Z. Now it's going all the way to numax or minus one or whatever. So at that point, it would say, okay, I can combine these loops, clearly. It will. The compiler knows enough to do that. The only time it might not do something like that is if like you passed A on to something like a function for reals. In this case, it's not passed on. It's simply used. Well, it is passed into something, but it's like you passed a pointer to it or a modifiable reference to it, then the code might say, oh, well, it could have been modified, and therefore we don't want to assume just combine these loops together. But on the other hand, it might look at them and say, well, let's see, like, consider the case where A changed in either of these situations. Well, it would be different, wouldn't it, if A were written and changed while this was about to become Z or whatever. It wouldn't start over at Z at any point here, no matter what it does with X and Y happening. Well, that's kind of a point too, is like you can't really modify it until it's there, is it? At least not as far as like messing with. I don't know, it's interesting analysis. Look into it closer. When I give a damn. Okay, so at this point, whoa, something got broke. Something got broke. What did I do and why? Oh. does not like with an access enum and an int. Look at that. The min is actually a thing too. What do you know? Freaking crazy. Okay, well. You know, if I had like a last access, something like that. Hello? Oh my god. There is one, but it's way over here. Has hot end, it's E, otherwise it's Z. Well, this thing it is. Yeah, no. I guess that's just... It's nice to have these funky things, but it's like you define it once, you use it once, and then it's like... polluting your stuff forever. People look at it and go, why? What does this mean? Why is it here? What makes it so important that it belongs in the high-level conditionals, buddy? Watch it, buddy. Okay, so I feel like in this case, yeah, would it say, hey, A could have been modified? Well, in our case, no. So actually, it will combine these loops. But if there were a case where A could have been modified through a reference or a pointer to A, then there's a case to be made for the fact that the loops would not be combined at all. And also would not be unrollable. Well, maybe they would be unrollable, I guess, because you would be saying something to the effect of, well, whatever A is, it's going to do it, right? And it's only going to, it's just going to check that condition when it's done. The question is, why would you ever modify it, you know? You wouldn't. You jump to the last one is about the only sense. And then when you did, this would fail. And increment it after you did your thing. Bear it. And so, wild, man. Okay, well, I can see so many cases where I'm like, oh, that looks like it should be loopy too, huh? Clearly, home item in, right? Home item, we'll go with. We'll just go with home item. And we'll go with end. Do 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 do. Been through this before, right? Notice how they all have A on them? So, yeah. Fine, home item in. Mm-hmm. G28. Oh, look at that. Yeah, we have that too. You can always look that up. Boom. All the axes have a string you can pull out. That takes care of that. Now all I have to do is this. Map axes, I've got to find how to do it. Axis map. Map. Main axis map. There it is. So yeah, I chose map. You could use repeat. But main axis map, it just puts the letter there. Repeat uses like the this, it'll use like A axis, B axis, C axis, etc. Did I just say etc? Oh my god. I must be tired. Whoosh. It's Latin. It's the Latin word for and, which is et. Then also, which is cetera, et cetera. And if you look at an ampersand, it's actually an E and a T and a C kind of glommed, or an E and a T, I should say, glommed together. Sometimes a little C maybe ish in there. But yeah, an E and a T squished together. Because it's just quicker to write it that way. Et. Et. But after a while, it lost its meaning, and nobody sees et anymore when they look at an ampersand. It's really strange. That's all I see anymore. Damn it, my Latin class ruined me. So yeah, the main axis map, in this case, I could do something to the effect of, oops, I forgot this part. Oop, there you go. Main axis, so should I say main axis code? I don't know if that's even a thing. Main axis code, no, it's not. Main axis map. Home item. I think that's all I have to do. Done it before, and I'll do it again. And I guess I can leave off the semicolon. Bye-bye. So nice to see those go away, isn't it? Oh no, here we are again. By the way, that has its that's its lifetime. So yeah, here we are again. Home item. If enabled, oh I see, and if disabled. So in either case, you still have it. Boop. Boop. Main axis map, home item. Boom, done. Guess I can just call that done right there. Just squish it down. that's nice. Isn't that great? And you can do that. Oh, I guess I'm gonna put a semicolon there anyway, just because it looks neater. And my, I don't know. I'm sure something, some syntax thing will be like complaining about it if I don't. So here, if enabled. End of actual, interesting. If enabled it, then it does it. Otherwise, not. Yeah, see, look at that. If enabled, submenu, else. No, you can't have that be that. That can't be right. Obviously not. Okay, made that into an int, so things will pass. This too shall pass. Then we got enabled. What? That makes no sense. Oh, menu. There it is. Okay. I don't know why I saw menu, submenu, etc. Yeah. Of course. Okay, so we're looking at the same thing, same here thing. Okay, back item, G-code item, main axis, like, I don't know, I feel like I guess maybe I wanna make it work better. Oh look, I have one there too. Case move. Break. All right, that's happy. Looks happy. Yeah, same idea here. Main axis map, home item. Yes. Yeah. Call it an action item, I guess. But yeah, the way these are generally set up, you can see it's like G28X, G28Y, which is, you know, does feel kind of silly to have them do it that way. It should call directly, but we're putting it into the buffer. Like, let it fall naturally into the flow of what's going out. Even in Marlin, we don't like put commands at the front. So that, you know, that in some cases we can do things like modify something directly. Like, so that's, you know, we have cheats. But generally speaking, a lot of the time we're trying to avoid that, sticking anything in the front of the queue. There have been some proposals now to allow hosts to stick stuff, run commands directly without, you know, bypassing the queue entirely, which I don't necessarily favor because they're just kind of not set up to be run outside of the queue. So I feel bad about it, but okay, it was easy to miss that was menu and versus submenu. Gosh, I gotta say, don't edit when really tired because you'll just miss those three little letters that make all the difference. So let's fix the thing. Loop. Oops. Oops. Loop. And then, more main axis map. Use of map. I'm really going to have to pull some of this into a separate piece or merge it directly. Torn between PRs and stuff. Just merging directly times. If it seems fairly obvious like this, like it used to be that these were kind of risky because the macros were all sketchy and in development and I didn't know how they worked. Map, especially, I don't know why, it was killing me to get it working. But eventually I got it to work. But I kind of picked an obvious path to implement it. Which, you know, I won't bore you to death with it, but because I know you don't love code or anything. You're just here for the yucks. But yeah, I did an eval of map and basically followed the same exact pattern as for repeat, where you have like a pair of macros, one is an alias of the other. And so you can actually call the alias, which isn't an alias, it's a macro that returns you, returns the macro that you're in, basically. So you can call it to return itself, but if you don't have it return itself right away, you can defer it. It doesn't get painted blue or whatever. And so it's allowed to do the execution at the later point in the way that macros are evaluated. But in essence, like you could think of a macro where everything happens right in place. And so it's sort of like, in that way, it's like if you've used OpenSCAD and written functions in that, which aren't modules, but actual functions that return a value, you can do things like return a whole array or whatever. So it doesn't have, it can be kind of complex. Like if you wanted to sort an array, there are probably, I believe there's a way you can bubble sort just using a function, but it's very tricky because it has to be recursive. Essentially, anything you build has to be recursive, or it has to have kind of like a tail to it. It has to have some final return, but it can call it within itself, and it can do conditions. So by making things recursive, you can do some very cool things with them. And the same way, macros, C++, can also do some fairly neat things, but you to follow the logic can be astoundingly hard, especially when, you know, what does if else even mean? And you have to go study that and how it was implemented and what it does. And in essence, you know, it gives you an idea. Okay, if something is not zero, it gives you the first thing in parentheses. Otherwise, it gives you the other thing in parentheses. And the thing is, the things in parentheses are magic, are magic things. Because there's a substitution that happens here where it'll either call the something that emits, it'll produce some a thing that he doesn't emit of the first thing, or a thing that does an emit of the second thing. I want to say not an emit of the second thing, but doesn't emit the first thing and therefore ends up emitting the second thing. Take a peek at it at some point, but it, suffice it to say, studying the macros that we ended up actually incorporating into Marlin, just the family that we picked and the way that we chose to do it, sometimes it's a little, like, if you look at these, obviously, these are in a sense really obviously bad. Like, you can see why, like, but the thing is that they're super simplified. Like, you make a list of whatever, and it emits that whatever. If the thing has commas in it, it can be funky. It can, funky things can happen. So these are direct. They do one level. But there are some that do multiple levels, calling list or whatever. But yeah, these are meant to be emitted by a thing that's a do or whatever, or, you know, counts the number of things and then emits that. There are ways I can work out. Yeah, like, all it's doing is it's putting commas between those things. And then when you want to emit, like, some number of things, you have a thing that's like, yeah, give me the right one. And that's kind of how it works. It's you do selectors, essentially, and then you emit the macro you want, and then that macro gets the arguments that you want to pass on to it. You get really, really tricky with them. But in essence, you kind of, you build up your knowledge slowly and hopefully don't go too crazy. But yeah, this file is worth a study for sure for anyone just kind of like really interested in the metaprogramming side of C++, because it is in some parts kind of super obvious, like that again. Like the do macro is kind of what that's all built around, which was something I don't know if that was something I came up with or borrowed, but in essence, it's the same idea as anything. It's like you have it do something many times, whatever it is, and you emit that all in one line. It can, and this is actually for use with things like if enabled, you know, list of things, if both these two things or whatever. And this is meant to just kind of join them together with a joiner. So, or not necessarily, like, actually this, I should say, the do part doesn't necessarily do the joining part, but I use it, the enabled stuff, to do joining. And so there is a joining that happens because when you, it's meant to chain these things. So it'll emit one of them, and then wraps it in parentheses is all the first one item does. And then it goes on to pass the rest of the arguments on to the next one. So if there's 36 items in, it'll emit, you know, it'll emit them in order, 1, 2, 3, through 36, but it emits them through this process of using this bit to build that. I'm sure there's got to be a better way. Like, I probably, now that I have a working repeat, I'm kind of confident I could do something along these lines, get rid of all this, these do's. But the thing is, you have to have something to call. And so it's like, you know, I guess you would say you would the repeat takes care of the countdown for you, so, or the count up for you. And so all you have to do is just make sure to pass the arguments in that you need. The one tricky thing I had was that this does a do with, it uses a, again, it's an expression, a joiner, and then whatever follows. And so you have, like, you know, for each step it's passing on the eats one expression, passes on the next expression, the joiner, and the remainder of the expressions, and then goes on and on and on. until it's done, until it gets up to one, and then that wraps the whole thing in parentheses, and you have something that can be evaluated by the preprocessor. So in the case of, like, I use do a lot for different things, but enabled was one of those cases. You can see here, here's enabled. It's just simply defined as, first I had to create, well, things like cat are very common. All this does is takes whatever you pass to it and the rest after a comma and joins them together. Joins everything together, and I believe that the V ends up, it ends up all just being joined. I'm not sure how it all works, but and so you can call cat once, and then it'll evaluate the A, and then it'll join it. So if you use if you need something to be evaluated before it's joined, you call cat. If you need something to just be joined, you call this one, and hopefully it doesn't get evaluated before it gets joined. No, I'm fairly sure there's some guarantee-ish to that. It has a comma in it. I don't know. It's up to you. Anyway, then the next thing that happens is you have these macros, which are is and nay, which is and nay. This is my cheat. I don't know if this is how you would typically do it. But you make a dummy argument, comma one. Okay, so, and then another one. And these all represent, if I concatenate some value that I have that is blank. So if I do a define like this, define Alice. Alice is actually now defined as a blank. So there is actually a value. It just is blank. It'll be treated as zero sometimes. So if I say now if Alice equals zero, you know. Wow. I know, I can't believe it either. This will actually this error because it does equal zero. You know, if you say if Alice is less than 10, this will be less than 10. If you say something like Alice is equal to gray, and gray doesn't equal something that can be evaluated, you'll end up with gray is less than 10, and then that might evaluate that as being true and then say wow. However, so there is some case where I can't remember. Oh yeah, if you do this, what was it? Like that? Exactly. It might be like this actually. I know if you say equals zero, it knows what to do. But if you say less than something, maybe that if I'm in an expression or whatever, I don't know. There was some case I remember where it was like, I don't like it because it's got less than in it. But anyway, so it's basically zero. So yeah, that's some fun. Anyway, when you can, so the idea there is I'm concatenating whatever is defined. So if I defined something as one, I defined it as true, or I defined it even as OX1, which I think came up somewhere. I think it was because true or false was defined that way, and then it would get evaluated in some expression somewhere and get through this macro stuff. And so this would get emitted, so I had to actually include that for true. And then true sometimes is just true, because it actually can be the compiler knows what true means sometimes, I guess. Depends on C or C++, so yeah. Sometimes C doesn't know what it is until you tell it, I guess. So yeah, and then you got, it might be C99, I don't know. Is an A, and so yeah, and so then I built up this thing, which is an A, and all this does is call isProbe on my, whatever I give it, V, which is, you know, okay, is an A V. Whoa. So what is isProbe and what does isNAV do? What the heck is that all about? Well, isn't it, he'll pass on everything to his probe. So what happens here is I go, so this is what's going to get passed on. It's either going to be this or something else is going to get passed on. Spoiler alert. So when I do NA1, which is how I build for my do stuff, you have to have whatever your whatever your thing is going to be, it has to end in underscore one. So that's how that works. So we start out here. My first doer, it's my very first doer I ever made, is an A passing, and I'm very careful here. It'll be to like not take is an A, which actually is a thing, and include it in here like this. I don't want to do that, so I have to concatenate is with an A, which is a little silly, but that's the way I do it with the thing. So all of this, just all that does is evaluates the concatenation. So it gives me, then it is probes on it. So whatever symbol you give it is going to get concatenated. It's going to produce either this or probably blank or nothing or itself. Actually, what ends up happening is if it's like is an A and something is not defined at all, it'll actually end up being is an A blah blah blah, because it can't go any further than that. It just has to leave it at that spot, and so that ends up getting passed on to something, and so that ends up being treated as a zero. And so that's what this cleverly does for us, is it means that anything that doesn't come out like this with a comma in it and a one after the comma is going to not work for purposes. So basically, as long as we can trust that what's being passed in is pretty much all the time, it's going to be the names of options. So that's how these generally work. For this purpose, it'll work. And so what does isProbe do? IsProbe is defined a little later, but it takes the second item in a list that has what you pass to it and a zero. So what does that mean? Well, if you pass to it something that doesn't have a comma in it, second item is going to be zero. Pass something that has a comma in it, second item is going to be this. Yeah, so because it concatenates it beforehand, before the zero, so it and it passes it on to this list taking the second item. And the thing that takes a second item is very simple. You can see that very easily too. All that does is if you give it a list, A, B, and whatever, gives you B. Same with first. First, you give it A and whatever, it gives you A. Third, A, B, C, whatever, gives you C. And it doesn't care. If you leave off, you know, just A, it'll give. So yeah, those are really handy, and those are actually then used in as part of the tricks in the macro world here. Macro world. So yeah, that's really fun to play with these. So that and then the do part of this is then enabled, is defined as give me, you know, whatever, and then you pass that on. You call do, you say, I want you to use the NA1. Knows to put an underscore and then a one on the front, underscore on the front and a one on the back. And there's a reason I defined it that way. I don't remember exactly. Oh, it has to do with the fact that you want this to be one, but then you want numbers on all the rest. And maybe there's a way I could tricky get out of that. There's some tricky way I think I could get out of that where I don't need to do that. Because, but you can see that the W in all these needs to be there. The W being, this is the W. The W, I don't know what I meant for it to stand for. Do whatever, I guess? Do what? I guess it stands for what. What do you want to do? When do you want to do it? What is your favorite color? What is the airspeed velocity of an unladen swallow? Enabled. So yeah, and then you pass on the operator you want to join, and then the rest of the arguments, which I usually just call V, because this is a trick. You can say V dot dot dot, and here you don't have to say VA args or whatever, which is what you normally have to do. Ugly. It's hideous. Don't do it. There, maybe it'll take this. I don't know. Use V. And then dis, same idea, just uses dis, which is just a not version of an A, which basically takes whatever the result of an A is and puts a not in front of it. Or I should say, is does an is probe on the thing. So it gets a little weird, but yeah. Not. Does an is probe on the thing and the not, the x. So it cats a not on the thing. Not x, cat not x, is probe cat not x. Okay. How can I possibly not something by catting? What am I catting when I cat over here? Like if I do an A1, aren't I gonna get, oh, yeah, now you see. It's passing the knot on through the entire thing. So it's knotting everything, basically. So if you, when you take an A1, you get back this whole is an A thing, which is probe, but not of an is probe is what you get, basically. So yeah. There might be a way to do reverse this also. Like you could, for example, you could simply say not on this do ENA and get rid of this altogether. You don't need it. You don't need it because that actually works just fine in preprocessor world. So yeah, you could consider that. Might be neater, you know? I don't really know. At this point, it's kind of locked in, right? It does look neater being there, and it's more symmetrical. You know, you have your enable, you have your disable. This is just obviously not an A, right? But yeah, it's like I almost want to make something like, you know, is this? Is this? But yeah, actually everything evaluates as zero otherwise. So it's like it's good to have the thing. But yeah, to look at not again. Let me see, define not. Is probe cat not x? So strange, isn't it? But yeah, you're basically catting a not onto the thing. So you get a not zero and you get a one out of it. So you can see it's using the underscore cat, which is interesting, but it still ends up evaluating the thing that gets passed to it because it's still second level. So X gets, I should say, evaluated. A better way to say it would be expanded. So not whatever gets expanded. So so the thing that is an A bit that is initially is probe returns just the zero or the one, you get the one, and then you is probe it, and you get back the, not zero gets one, anything else gets zero, not zero gets zero, wait, cool, that's interesting, anything else gets one. Should say bool. 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 Zero gets zero. Anything else gets one. Right? Because it's not not. It's a not not. Pretty clean, and it definitely does a reduction. But yeah, in each of these cases, one of the things I really kind of wanted to do was to have the thing evaluate in place and then only pass on to the next, like in the case of an and, for example, like if you knew that it was gonna end here, you didn't need to put in the rest. I guess in a way, like you can't do that. You're expanding and it can't evaluate the thing until it's actually expanded. The whole thing has to be expanded before it even gets over to the if and says, okay, now I'll do that. But yeah, I was looking for some way where, like, if it emitted a, like, if something emitted a zero or added up to a zero, you would make that the name. You would concatenate that zero onto the thing you would call for the next step. So at each step, it would be like, oh, well, I got to this point, it was zero, and the rest just get eaten. But the thing is, I think it would still have to emit them all, you know? So it's like, you know, is there a way to stop them getting emitted is really the question in the long run at all. With repeat, clearly you can, because it uses numbers to count. But with the case of like evaluating conditions one after another, I don't know. Maybe there is, well, yeah, I guess I could see how that would work, because it has that it had that if else bit. You just have to use the if else in the right way. I don't know. A lot of clever stuff going on here in macro world. I got again, viciously distracted from whatever it was I was working on here at 3:25 a.m. Austin, Texas. Folks outside gabbing. Any not disabled these. Right. None disabled, all enabled, both, all, with just the first two things. Both is handy, it prevents you from having too many things. Either, again, any, many. I used many earlier for something. So yeah. I was curious if why that map ended up ever working. Map actually on the repeat was even more like weirdly complicated as far as self-contained macros go. I mean, now that you understand kind of how sub one works, how if else works, and things like that, you get the general idea. If else is actually a fascinating one. Again, well worth a study, but basically, if else bool TF, what? That's all it does. What does that even mean? Okay, well, let's look at if else. Oh, cats and if. So it either gives you an if 0 or an if 1. Well, what does that do? Well, an if 1 passed some argument does that thing. And then an if one else, which evidently eats the rest of the argument. Looks like. If you, or no, if one else, what does it do? I don't know what it does. He's naming if one else here, which is curious. Like, see how it says definition of if one else. B followed by if one else. Oh, yes, you know what? It emits the name if one else, which is a function that takes whatever and emits nothing. So in this case, our if else is either going to emit if one, which emits everything and then nothing, or I should say, and then the name of nothing, which is going to be used to take thing in parentheses that follows. Then you have an if 0, so that's kind of part of the key here, is that these things, these tails here, are meant to marry some parentheses in the map arg later, in the map later. These are used in other ways, but you can see, or in repeat, I should say. Meanwhile, if zero, well, that just emits as if zero else, which, what does if zero else do? It takes something and emits the V. It emits it. So, good to know. So, let's take a look and see what happened. So one, in one case, it emits the first thing and throws away the second thing. In the other case, it throws away the first thing. Seems to have thrown away the first thing. And emits the second thing. It would seem. But what do I know? Because, like, if one else takes some, yeah, I mean, it's going to emit if one or if zero. Eh. Remember, I've wrapped my head around this many times. But in essence, let's say this thing was not zero. So it ends up emitting if one. Taking, so this if else turns into if one, taking this bit here. So you end up doing that. It emits this part, and then it emits if one else, which is followed by these parentheses here. See? You see? And then what happens is, that whole bit gets evaluated, so you end up with an if one else in front of this, and an if, or I should say it's going to have the, yeah, if one else in front of this, but this is going to get emitted, and if one else doesn't do anything, it just throws it away. So that's the case in both cases. So in either case, that's your path that it follows. But then at the end, when it comes out zero, after subtracting one, you get a different result. You get if zero comes out. So what happens in if zero comes out? Well, the first thing here, nothing is simply, let's say, I want to say it emits nothing for the first bit. But that's what it looks like to me, yeah. Basically, yes, that's what it does. So it first thing it does is, yeah, it's the if one, if zero, first of all, it takes this first part itself. This is actually taken by the if one or if zero bit. That's important to consider. And then the second part here is taken by whatever's at the end of it. So the if zero else. So you see here that the if zero takes this first bit and here passes it on, as it were. It puts that part here in the parentheses and then does nothing with it. It doesn't emit it like it does here. Then it sticks an if zero else in front of these other parentheses, and that actually does emit something. It could put an if one, I would think, actually. But you see, you would think it could put an if one in front of it, but it couldn't because it would end up going forever in a little loop. That's why you have to have an if one and an if one else, an if zero and an if zero else. One is to grab is to emit the first, not emit the second. The other one is to not emit the first, and then two emit the second, and then these parentheses cleverly become the arguments of the macros that are named at the ends of these macros. It's really crazy. So yeah, you got to remember that everything is being done as is all. It's a really weird machine, but if you've ever read Gödel-Escherbach, it reminds me a lot of like the string building system that you kind of have in that little world where you have these things that are in, you know, that can keep re-looping into themselves and so forth. So when you look at repeat, the first thing it does is it takes an I, which is like the current index that's going to get repeated. And this is not repeat itself. This is the repeat helper, so to speak. It gets jumped into by the repeat. And so other repeat macros use this as the actual workhorse. And again, this is all like done in place, emitted by the preprocessor based on information that's all available at the time of the evaluation of this line, the first time that the preprocessor runs into it. It's dealing with all this kind of crap. So this thing is the workhorse, and it takes the current index, and it takes the number of things that there are left, I guess, in the list that it's going to process, and an operation, which is the name of a macro that should get called with the current index. So as you can see, right, first thing that happens is it does the op with the index, and it's supposed to have its own semicolon after it, so it doesn't put one here. And there's reasons for that too. Like it doesn't need a semicolon, maybe it needs a comma, things like that. So all that's left out here. You emit those yourself out of your repeat op. Then it does the thing to see whether it should continue or not. And when it continues, basically all it does is just do repeat again by adding one to the index, subtracting one from the number that are left, and passing on the name of the operator to do. And then it uses this underscore repeat, which is here, and defers it by two, which is not sure why two exactly, but it works. Other numbers don't necessarily work, so. But this one does, so let's trust it. You'll see if you end up with stuff that's emitted out of macros and they have problems in them, you get big lists that are ugly. And that's one of the things that sucks about using these, is just that it'll say, oh, the evaluation of this macro inside this macro and inside this macro inside this macro, this happened. And then you try to figure it out, and it's like, why did I do this to myself? What I should do is add some kind of like, at least like filtering on the errors that come out somehow in platform IO maybe, and just like, or at least the terminal, I don't know what else, but just get it, hide that stuff somewhere. Or give me an option to hide it. So anyway, it's unavoidable though, because of these are needed for the way that this thing's built. One of those unavoidable things. Anyhow, so this does is it's a macro that returns the name repeat, which is the name of this macro. So it's not like it actually, and then this thing, this defer to, basically says, this repeat here is going to come out after it gets evaluated. It's not being evaluated right now. We're going to evaluate it. Pass it on to the evaluator. So basically it doesn't get painted, blah, 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 until later. And so as a result, the evaluator can handle it. Really strange factors about why you can't just say, oh, hey, do this. For one thing, it doesn't recognize that it exists. So it's like, okay. But if you do this, then it somehow notices that this does exist. And it may have to do with just levels, layers, when this gets evaluated. Like, there's a first pass, and then there's a second pass. It may be that these passes are happening through the whole pile. I don't really exactly know. But they're definitely happening in such a way that this becomes available as long as it's deferred. So for the moment, it's just a string that gets passed on. Then, since there is nothing called underscore underscore repeat that can do anything as a string, Ooh, BQ sensor almost ready. Ooh, things are happening. I can't talk about everything that's happening, but things are happening. So yeah, this is so yeah, that becomes a string basically until the parentheses pop up in front of it, and then it's like, oh, I should try and see what that does, and it returns that, which does that, which then gets this stuff, and it may have to do also with being having all these things available. So I've seen other things where it says, I don't even know what this means. It's like, why don't you know what that means? And it's because I didn't, you know, you didn't defer this long enough, so I didn't get these. You're the evaluator. But yeah, so this little workhorse, and then the basic repeat macro just calls it with, well, first there's a repeat s that takes, again, an I, which is going to be the first value, which is typically going to be 0, sometimes 1. 0 is, you know, typical. You'd want to do zero-based indexing. And then the next number is one, see, it is subtracting that first value from the total number that you've given it to repeat. So if you said go from 3 to 10, it'll say, okay, I'm gonna go 7 things. Or yeah, it should, it's actually gonna do 8 things, but it sets the n to 7, subtract 3 from 10. So, and then the actual repeat itself, yeah, it does it from 0 to n minus 1, basically. But you can see here that the repeat s does pass on the n itself, but repeat s does go from to n minus 1. So whatever n you pass is, you're actually getting a zero-based index loop, but it'll loop that many times, 20 times, whatever. It's from 0 to 19. Here you have repeat 1, and that just repeats again. It passes increments n, and then subtracts 1 again. So, you know, whatever, it works. But it goes from 1 to n, so 1 to 20 instead of 0 to 19. Again, and you can see it's very simple at this point. You know, it makes perfect sense. I'll subtract s from n, even though that's the weird way to do it. It works. You could say sub, I think I might even have like a sub macro that like you just say s comma n, but eh, this works. But yeah, that's all that does. So that works very well. And then the same idea is like if I wanted to do a repeat inside of a repeat, I couldn't do that. There was an issue with that, so I made a repeat. Well, this is op with arguments. So that's repeat with arguments. Plus arguments, yeah. I don't know why I called it repeat too. Here's a bad name for it. What do you think? I'm gonna figure out a better name for it. Maybe repeat A with args. Repeat P with repeat with parameters. I don't know. Repeat A might work though. But R repeat does is used for nesting. Yeah. So I basically it's an exact duplicate of these macros repeated exactly. And I could have put them up there so that they're even more obvious that they're duplicates, but I didn't. I just did not. So yeah. If you do nesting, you have to do that, and I didn't get into more than two levels of nesting, ding, and nor will I. Why I'm belching so much? What have I eaten today? Oh, it was those stupid snacks. I actually have some really good burgers that veggie burgers. I haven't. They just thawed out. Should they're I'm supposed to use them within a couple days. Thawing, so I'm gonna try them. They're the Beyond Meat or whatever, Beyond Burger, whatever. Beyond, and I got some buns which I like, which are like these pretzel style. You've probably seen them. They're the buns that I will eat. If I don't have, if I get other buns, like 8 of them, I'm like, four of them will go bad because I just can't eat them. Too fluffy. These are good. They're just like, here, it's a pretzel in your face. If you don't like it, put mustard on it. Just eat the rest. You're good. So yeah, in the end, map became this, call op A, which I ended up calling map op, instead of rift op. Ah, clearly we're tired tonight. And map op, you do the map op again, no punctuation. And you do your if else. That's all that map did. And then, but the difference here was that you take one item from your mapping thing, which is a list of stuff. And I learned this from the do thing, where you take one item or two items. And there's another thing I hadn't done, but I could build a do that takes two items. And I think I did that for some of the serial macros. Yeah, serial macros that they take even odd number, whatever, but they, you know, even ones and odd ones do different things. Yeah, this one was interesting because it goes to get the first item and then eats that. And so A, map up A, and then does has args. So I used has args. And has args, as long as it returns a 1 or a 0, you're good. And it turns out that it does. I don't remember when I added has args, but yeah. When I noticed that it was there, and I was like, wait a minute, that evaluates as a 1 or 0, doesn't it? Then I can use it for this if one else stuff. Do it. You don't have, you know, and it is a bool. It basically is a bool. As long as it's a bool, you're good. But yeah, so I ended up using it. And sure enough, like, wow. and all has args does is look at. There's probably another way you could do it too. Like, you can do a count args. And so, you know, I could say, just give me a bool of count args. And as long as it's not zero, then you're good. Bool will return. So I could have done that. Have done that, but didn't. I won't. I might. We'll see. But right now, you got those. You can see the ifs are slightly different. Yeah. So same deal. Parentheses to do something and do nothing in the second case, but recurse in the first case. Little thing. He returns a thing, and it does the thing. I don't know what I was trying to do before, but it wasn't this. It didn't work. And I didn't know why. And I'll never look back, because this is fine. It's consistent. It's friendly. I recognize it. The thing is, there's no recursion of map. I don't know where you would do a map of a map. You can see repeat of a... repeating a thing that repeats, but mapping a thing with a map in it. I guess you could do a map of a thing with a map in it, but I don't get it. you'd be mapping one thing and you'd be mapping something else. So anyhow, never needed to. But I didn't need a map list, and in this case, I had to figure out where to put the comma. Turned out that, hey, check it out. You know what? You put the comma in the place where it's going to continue or not. And then it's like, oh, of course. It's going to continue, you put a comma before the next thing, and then you're good. If it's not going to continue, you never need that comma. You never get a comma. It does the one op, and it's done. As long as there's more than one, you'll get that comma. There won't be an extra comma at the end, which is important. I didn't want no extra dangling commas. They suck. So I don't like them. But yeah, this worked out well. All overall, like, very simple. Eat the first argument, pass on the rest. Yeah, metaprogramming, I don't necessarily recommend it for firmware. In some cases, yeah, this was an issue where we needed something that would build, you know, consistently and in the right way. Compat, hold on. Did it in both places, didn't I? Now what? I had such good luck with these things passing until now they don't. Why? Where? Oh. Let's take a look. No, G2. Yeah, that seems like it must be real. I didn't want to believe it, but. Inflicted types, again. Why? Why won't you? Why? You don't like that? You don't like that? Why? I think I actually did fix that, but I haven't pushed it yet. See, where is it? Yeah, I just haven't pushed it. Okay. Guess I should look at some of these things. Item N. Any more of these? No. Wow, I was really hoping for more. They were fun to fix. I like seeing so many lines reduced. Got rid of a good 22 lines there or whatever. And yeah. Total of 46 lines or something like that. Removed. I guess it'll tell me. 8 added, 55 removed, so yeah. 47. Pretty good, pretty good. Cutter. So foam cutter, I guess, is pretty much ready to go. I believe. Yeah, let's commit that. New. Sure, I'll let you have a fancy sparkle. Why not? Here you go. I'm telling you, you don't see Linus Torvalds out on Twitch working on the Linux kernel. You're lucky to have me, folks. I'm just kidding. I'm lucky to be alive, honestly. My this is the age my dad was when he died. I feel like, ow. I'm so spry. I get it. I mean, I'm sleepy as fuck, but Yeah. That was a while ago. Anyhow, I've been being a good vegetarian for a year, so. But my sleep schedule's gonna be the death of me, I tell you. I tell you, folks. If you got a Z, you go from Z to the number of axes. Take a minute. And you tell your friends about it. Cool, I trust that. And oh, okay, I looked at all the things and I liked it. Of course, I understand if there's some sensible default on some weird ramps boards that use. I know, I was just reading this comment and I'm replying to it. What's going on in his head? Yeah, so what was going on in my head was, if the whole idea of having the end stops, I was thinking, well, are there some ramps boards that might have diag pins, you know, like signed trinamic sensorless end stops, sensorless homing rather, like it uses stall to detect an end stop. Yeah, I don't know. Yes, I've been looking at crazy flat earth conspiracy crap. It really makes me laugh. Or, I don't know, I just need to have that shake my head moment of the day. Like, but on the other hand, you know, like what used to be the thing was I was really into being inspired. So I'd read all these really great authors and like seek out TED Talks and stuff. That stuff started to really wear on me as like more of the TED Talks became too hypey. I was like, oh man, I used to be so into it. Like Omni magazine, man, when I was a kid, oh, it was so cool. I look back now and I'm like, oh, this is so pseudo science and woo-woo, and oh, there's so much of that woo in there. It's just like really astounding to like go back and look at it. Like I'm the same way now with like going through some of the old stuff that used to inspire me, amuse me. Like, I remember when I first discovered podcasts, right? That was like a big thing. And then it was like Ken Nordine. I was like, oh, this guy's got the coolest voice, and he's doing all this really weird stuff. And then, like, Ken Nordine, man, like, the first couple hours, you're like, wow, this is really cool. This guy's awesome. You know, that Edward Lear poem, man, that's neat. And then he has his own stuff, and it's like, yeah, cool. But then it starts to really grate on you after a while, and you're like, hey, Levi's, you know what? I'm done. And then that's done with Ken Nordine, so. But yeah, it's funny that, I don't know, ebbs and flows, you know, it's like I really was a fan of Strong Bad. I think that that's one of the things that still actually holds up because it's funny and goofy and stupid. It's just like it has its own stupid goofiness to it. Kind of still fits in that perfect niche. I'm still waiting for the Strong Bad movie, which, you know, could be a thing at this point. Where's the Kickstarter for Strong Bad movie? We need it. Honestly. I can do a pretty good Strong Bad voice if someone needs a filler. Or if you need, like, you know, a group of Strong Bads to, like, have a big argument or something, I can join in. I'm there. You know, I won't do it now because it bother my neighbors, but you'll hear my strong back one of these days. I will slowly fall into it sometime at some point while I'm working, and you'll have to put up with my strong bad. Sorry. Okay, this is all it's getting late, and I'm hungry. Like 4 a.m. And I feel like now I've got videos. I've got I have not watched my videos today. I'm really behind on my stories. know, what's going on with the Q5 commission, and you know, where's the, you know, where's the latest accidental, you know, bubble factory explosion where all these people got sudsed to death or something. I gotta catch up on the news, you know. What's going on out there? Yeah, there's a bunch of more. There's still a few more PRs that I gotta go through, but you know, I'm gonna start bright and early tomorrow. Wait for that, I guess. I'll dive into them. I have all this kombucha that I made, and it's really so super fizzy. You know, what I really need is a good way to tap. I know that there's a, you can, if you're brewing, you can let off the gas slowly, and like, and it won't explode on you. And with these things, I'm like, I'm letting it off, and it's like, nope, can't open it. I have to let it sit for another while, and then give it another try, keep trying until I can open it. I worry if I do that, it'll eventually stop being fizzy, but especially if it's in the fridge. But I, you know, I don't think so, right? Generally speaking, it just hasn't gotten flat on me. It's been very good. Good kombucha. Best kombucha I've ever made. Only kombucha I've ever made this whole year of kombucha making. It's been worthwhile. I was mentioning it yesterday a little bit. You know, everyone likes soda pop. Who doesn't? Soda pop, tonic, medicine, whatever you call it in your neighborhood. Egg cream, I don't know, but yeah. Seltzer. Yeah, but I like pop as much as the next guy. So, you know, Pepsi. I like my RC Cola, but I can't drink like sugary cola or anything. So I was like, well, I like kombucha and I guess it's easy to make. So, you know, I went and ordered the whole thing, ordered a SCOBY. But I left it in the fridge way too long. Just never got around to making it because I didn't feel like I had the space. So finally I did have the space and I was like, okay, try the SCOBY. Didn't work. That's when I discovered that it was pretty much gone at that point. Might not have really been, but I didn't give it a full chance. Anyway, it didn't seem right anyway. But hard to say what seems right and what doesn't with SCOBY. I think it was probably fine. In any case, it didn't work for me for one reason or another. I wasn't prepared to let it. So then I just got a bottle of kombucha and did the thing, you know, it says live on it, let it sit out, and then pour it into your batch of sweet tea and see what happens. And yeah, sure enough, that worked, you know, came to life, and we're off to the races. So yeah, I've been having a great time. Get those big SCOBYs. Using big jars, and yeah, I have to actually do another batch of tea today, because it's time to feed the SCOBY, and I can probably peel off a layer at this point, and maybe move it into a little SCOBY hotel. We'll see. This might actually be the SCOBY hotel at this point. I'll just pour off the liquid and use this as the hotel. It's funny that they call it a SCOBY hotel. I'd prefer a SCOBY motel, but customary at the name hotel. In France, I guess it's the SCOBY hotel. I suppose you could have a SCOBY hostel. Someone dropped in to chat to ask about computer science field as a career path. Sounds like they're in a different time zone from me, more awake than I am. It's hard to tell when people drop a chat if I'm not looking right at it, so I'm sorry if it's been a while. Let me reply. My thoughts on the field in general. Well, I like to code. I kind of just jumped into it. But I am trying to be more scientific. About it. How's that? That's the most best I can do. I'm trying to be more scientific about it. But yeah, computer science as a thing, I mean, as a field. Well, I mean, it's broad, isn't it? I mean, there's so many millions of things you could do in computer science. You know, it's almost like saying, you know, physical sciences, you know. Like, yeah, it's one niche of the physical sciences. The cool stuff that can happen in computer science, of course, you know, you could be working in chip fabrication, actually trying to figure out the next, you know, way to make silicone do magic things, you know. What's the next thing to dope it with? Who knows? Gallium arsenide was cool. Who came up with that? Yeah, like things like that that just, you know, take it to the next level. Quantum computing, huge area. No idea what's going to happen there. AI, the sky's the limit with AI. Actually, we should have a general intelligence AI. You know, once someone figures out how to put together various different AIs that are more specific to doing things, language, you know, understanding and things like that, but actually making these things interested, as so to speak, and working on improving their skills, there's gonna be, you know, it's gonna explode in crazy ways. So, you know, the singularity, you might actually end up working for the singularity, as opposed to having the singularity work for you in the future. It's hard to say, but I really feel like the sky's the limit. There's, you know, electronics is good stuff to have under your belt if you're doing computer science stuff. I think there's a, I kind of skipped it, and but it's a whole little microcosm of computing and unto itself, you know. Yeah, you have to regulate the voltages and make sure not too much current goes here and there. But the ultimate thing is that even the simplest circuits are logical. Switch goes on or off. Turning on a light, and that's, you know, one or zero. A light switch and a light bulb are one and zero. That's the simplest computer, so to speak. Or simplest circuit, simplest logic. And then, you know, logic gets more complicated. And these days with the, it was the Arduinos that got me to like jump into the, to really jump into the whole world of, well, sort of beyond just doing like wanting to write games or whatever. Like in game world, yeah, you know, you, these days you don't even have to write the physics. You just kind of like come up with the graphics and the, figure out the pacing, and then you build the art, and you build a world, like kind of like building a movie. In like, there's a lot more problem solving, and there still is, of course. But in all kinds of areas now, like there's more interesting problems to solve, it seems like. So yeah, you get into like these kinds of like robotics, AI, and robotics. They tie together really closely. The development of portable computers, little handheld ones, and AI at the same time is a really useful thing, because and the internet as well, because of course now they have a way to acquire sensory information, knowledge, language, you know, have conversations, interact, all that stuff is like available 24/7. So, you know, it's just there's the it's exciting. I mean, the hardest part about computer science is really just now figuring out or trying to decide what to do. Find your niche. But ultimately, I think the best thing is to build skills, you know, build skills and make stuff. And you know, you'll be doing that as part of your, you know, undergraduate or graduate program or whatever, your post-grad, your doctorate or whatever. As you go forward, like at each step, you'll figure out you'll find new areas of problem solving, and a lot of those will be areas that are like, you know, initially it's play problems, of course, even in the beginning there are plenty of play problems, especially now with all the new AI toys we have. that you know, you'll start playing with them and suddenly you have the next Google by mistake, or who knows what, because these AIs are, you think, well, I'll just play with it in this little area, the niche that nobody thought to play with it in before. And the next thing you know, you've got an AI that is able to do something better than any other tool that came before, you know, or is an expert or something along those lines. And I, you know, so I mean, I'm most excited, I guess, about AI. I would say more than almost anything else, just because, and it's being incorporated into, like, you know, 3D printers as well. As well. In particular, you know, visual, OpenCV, you know, being used, open computer vision, and that stuff is getting better all the time as it's being optimized in ways so it's going to identify objects and other things or whatever kinds of features you're looking for. And yeah, you can kind of start to define those and use them. And yeah, I think it's really exciting. Like, I mean, I would hardly even call the computer science itself like a singular field. You know, like if you're doing a data analysis, then that in itself is like, that's a whole world, that's a whole career. But you can go anywhere with it, you know, in the same vein with AI, you can go anywhere with that. And back in the day, I was like, you know, web design was sort of a gateway to being able to go anywhere, because you could take that on your laptop and go and do your job anywhere and work for people, you know, all over the world. It was easy to get remote work. And it was a nice way to combine, you know, design, casual writing, stuff like that, layout, get the basics, play with JavaScript, get hands-on with some frameworks. But yeah, I keep whispering, but hopefully the audio will be pick-upable in later viewing. We'll see how it is, but may end up posting this to YouTube or not. Yeah, I mean, as far as my path, and you know, I'm like, well, should I even answer this question about computer science? Because my path has been, you know, I just kind of started out as a young kid before computers were everywhere. They were starting to become everywhere. You had your, it came, went from people having consoles, their Ataris and so forth, 2600s, to suddenly having, you know, little computers in the 80s, Commodore 64s and Ataris, 800s and stuff, and TI-99/4As, I remember, was another one that came along. But yeah, there was those particular ones, and then some folks even had IBM PC when it came along. That was a big deal when the first, like, you know, initial real IBM PC with card slots and all that came out. Kind of mind-blowing, a big change. I was happy with my little computer because it had all this stuff going on inside of it. Graphics and stuff that kind of went beyond what the IBM PC kind of or felt like it had. So anyway, you know, I was happy in my little world of learning in that milieu for a long time. And then later I was like, well, I got disillusioned with that idea of making games and kind of like being stuck in computer geek land and sort of being on these deadlines and stuff, and just I didn't really like it. And I was young and I was like, well, gotta go and explore and learn, do other things. So you know, I just kind of went off, and I was not in, it was a good thing I did. There was no way I was gonna really, if I had my head in the right place or whatever, so to speak, as a young kid, and I knew what I was plan what eventually I would kind of get into and what I would find most interesting, I might have gone into engineering and computer engineering and software engineering and done that much more seriously and actually, you know, realized it was a path to kind of a life. But I was more interested in, like, you know, I was looking for experience and kind of getting out in the world. And I was like, if I stay here in Cape Cod where I was or whatever, you know, always the town you grew up in, I couldn't stay there. I had to get out. So it was like, I had my opportunity to go to Boston and just kind of have a new life. And I was like, okay. So, you know, but you get there and you have no connections. And so, you know, I didn't think to go pursuing any kind of like geek stuff. I was just, okay, going to play music, I'm going to hang out, I'm going to get a job or whatever at a restaurant, do what I have to do and just enjoy life and figure it out. A lot of people do that. It was like, there is a popular vision of the Portland in the 90s, man, where everybody was like, everybody worked in a damn pizza shop or a bar or something. But it's kind of real. It's kind of true. We all worked at motorcycle shops or bars or whatever, and it was just what it was. Never got the tattoos. But, you know, we had our time, and it was fun. You know, I needed to get out and kind of have a life a little bit, apart from trying to build a career and a family and all the kinds of things that were sort of expected of us or had been tried, done. And in our terms of where we were, it's like post-war, you know, boomer parents, Gen X kids, you know, whatever. There was, so at the time, it was like, there wasn't the vast, like, you know, field that there is now of computing, but there was an awful lot burgeoning. And of course, you know, you had skills and you had an interest, there were things you could do. I had a very good job at a mailing company doing like database, starting to work on their database. And I probably would have ended up reinventing the wheel just to get the stuff they needed working. But I could figure stuff out. But the world of databases itself was kind of like not something I was particularly, but I enjoyed like the process and kind of playing with the, again, it was like going in and playing with the computer and trying to make it do what they wanted me to do. And like, yeah, I could get it to do it. I don't even remember what I was programming in at the time. Now that I think about it, it was, yeah, whatever it was primitive, man. It was on an IBM PC of some kind. But it wasn't, it definitely was not assembly or anything like that. I really wish I had kind of picked up 86 x86 assembly back in the day. I had my 6502, I got my 68000. But I liked them because they were kind of neat, small, manageable. x86, you know, it was kind of ugly. Had that inverted, you know, endianness and stuff. So it was a little weird to get used to. But I think some people at that time were just like, ugh, the endianness, it's wrong. I was kind of like that. But yeah, again, like, I made my games. I had fun with the Amiga. I would have loved to have continued in that vein, but I was just like, I went on to just be poor. It wasn't like, I wasn't getting any help from, like, rich relatives or anything to put me through school. I was getting no guidance from some smart, you know, cousin or, you know, older brother working at some company, and just nothing was coming in as far as support or information about that. So, you know, I was just kind of feeling my way, and eventually, you know, had a trial marriage and all that kind of stuff, all the things you do as a young person. So at the moment, I'm kind of doing a bit of retrospecting lately, or, you know, looking back, reminiscing, as it were, or, you know, reevaluating life, kind of trying to see how I got here, who I am, what made me this person that I am, and, you know, what there is for me in, you know, terms of like a larger existence than just, you know, hanging out here, making my house great. A great place to geek. What beyond this, you know, can I do? And what happens after I move out of this place? What's next? The agenda. Like, there's a whole world out there, and like, I didn't necessarily choose Austin, so it's nice. I like the warmth. It's really great. People are friendly. I'm having a good time here. I have everything I need. It's just, it's almost too good. But the price is a little on the highish side, but it's not like to completely out of control. It's like reasonable compared to like what I was back in the, you know, say like 2000 in Portland, like, harking back to that time. The last time I had kind of a real job-ish that was as steady as this. And yeah, at that time it was paying like something like, I want to say 600 for a half a duplex. A little bit cramped. It was about the same size as this though. Now I'm paying 1,000 more than that. So, you know, I don't know if, you know, adjusted for inflation since 2000 is exactly double more is what I should be paying. Something like this. But the thing is, I am in the middle of Austin. At the time, I was in Southeast Portland, which a little out of the way, but still Portland, you know. It's pretty sprawling, but I wasn't any place like super desirable. I was in a nice spot though. Liked it. Anyway, let's talk about computer science for a moment. So I have to go over that whole period when I just didn't touch a computer. There really was a whole long time. And I don't know if I became smarter or better or at anything at the time. I did learn to play guitar and kind of worked on my music, wrote songs, and had a fun time. Learned a lot, read Dostoevsky and whatever, and just kind of like, you know, tried to understand things historically from the perspective of people who lived at various times, rather than looking at like news or propaganda per se. Even though, you know, everything is cloaked somewhat in experience, like, you know, you read enough samples, and I just really liked older literature. You know, it started initially with like things like Charles Dickens, of course. You know, gets you hooked early. And I remember we had this old first edition or something, or that probably wasn't a first edition, but it was an early edition copy of Christmas Carol or something, and it was like from the late 19th century. And I remember holding that thing and reading it and just being like, wow, you know, like, and so that kind of got me hooked early on and like started doing a lot of reading of different literature and different authors. I don't read nearly anything these days that I ought to. I've been consuming a lot of modern media, as we all have, but I try to appreciate it in the light of like, you know, it's a modern renaissance, isn't it? We're seeing burgeoning of art like we've never had before. Like every frame of some of these films that we make like is a masterpiece of artwork compared to like what has come before, just in terms of filling the wall space, right? And in terms of storytelling and stuff, we just have so much now. That's part of computer science. We didn't have that, you know, computer science and all the amazing stuff with AI and 3D that we now have. A lot of the stuff that we now take for granted, well, I'm sure we don't take it for granted. All the stuff that we enjoy but don't see kind of behind the curtain on is, you know, driven by all of this amazing data science that's going on now. So there's certainly, say, you know, never a bad idea to go into computer science, technology, engineering, math. But always keep in mind your need to make art, and, you know, keep a journal, make connections, try and like, you know, find different niches and tie your interests that are like more deep to the things that you do and kind of your work. Like if you can, I mean, a person who's an artist will like try entirely to like work their ideas into their art or whatever and kind of build their experience into their art and so forth. And we as technicians in computer science or whatever, I mean, we have art, we're artists. And we just work with different medium. And, you know, oftentimes the things that we build have to be built into a certain spec. But there are different ways we can approach it, you know. You can start building from the inside out, the outside in, bottom up, top down, you know, and all these approaches are valid. And, you know, they all come to inform the way we may do the next project or whatever. And like we all go through the same kind of processes, whether we call ourselves artists, you know, thoroughly, or whether we work in any kind of field that involves technology and some creativity or some thought or some, you know, craft, anything that requires your attention and your skill, is, you know, combines art and science. And there's nothing, you know, there's no need to like really make a big separation between them. I find it funny when I see people like decrying science, you know, some are scientists or whatever, as if they themselves are not part of the whole endeavor or not some way. It's not part of nature. I mean, it is part, it's just part of nature, man. We are seekers. We want to understand and master the world around us and engineer it and get things sorted out, you know. And data science is certainly super important right now, especially partly because of the problem that data science has created. All this internet stuff is created as just the explosion of data. Now we need machines, we need to build AIs that can digest that data and feed it back to us in digestible nuggets that, or, you know, explain it to us, show it to us in a more organized manner, or figure out the patterns in the data and discover those for us, because there's just stuff we can't see. There's so much going on out there in terms of activity in the network that is meant to undermine our existence, or maybe even help our existence. But, you know, the extent that these things are happening, like how much are those things being mapped and tracked and understood and digested, and to the extent that they're mapped and tracked and understood and digested, you know, what kind of solutions can be developed to deal with, say, misinformation, disinformation, things like that. These all come into play. I had thought early on, like when I first started getting back to computers, so there was a period of time when I was away from them, as I mentioned, and then I had to get back. And my father died, and I was like, there was a chance that I would be changing my lifestyle. And I was also, you know, engaged to be married, and so there was this whole, like, okay, what to do next? And so I knew I was going to have to move forward, and I just happened to pick up a PC, a cheap one, like a 286 PC or whatever, just to get my chops back together. And I wrote Tetris and started working on like guitar stuff to kind of do fretboard, show me chords on the fretboard, stuff like that. The things you do to kind of like get yourself back into programming. And you know, that eventually turned into a more big app later that I made on the Mac when I got Tosh and stuff. But yeah, I was like, you know, I just kind of learning to swim again, but picking up the new tools and seeing where we were at. And at that time, again, this was like, again, the mid-90s when I got back into it. So I had been away from about the late 80s to the mid to late 90s. So I could say I was maybe 7 or 8. I didn't go near a computer. And during that time, there was just so much came about, so much change, crazy. And the internet started to happen, and that was one part of the reason too when I felt I needed to get back into it as well. It was just meant to be, you know. It was time to 4:30 a.m. guys, so but yeah, it was fun to get back into it, because my brain was just, you know, it needed to, but it took me a long time to get back to a place where I am now. I really feel in the right spot. And what I mean by that is, in terms of computer science, I feel like I finally am embraced, you know, just doing it, for one. I have a space where I can. I have a project that completely consumes in my time and that I love working on because it's just such a fun technology. And I think that, you know, we'll all find our niche. We'll all find some place that we like, and you know, shuffle around. Just keep your ear to the ground, as it were, and keep working on your skills. You know, and don't let people put down your science, or call you a jerk because you just make art or whatever you are into. Like, there's great ways to mix and match, and the world needs art. It needs artists, and it needs people who make great things, beautiful things. And apparently more and more of them these days. You see the number of people who work on a typical movie, it's like thousands, man. So, you know, the important thing will be, you know, the hardest part is going to be taking care of our bodies as we're like being absorbed into this machine, right? Making sure to get enough exercise and get enough air, get enough sleep, problem for me, and just balance our time well. I'm completely, you know, able to do everything I need to do within this bubble here, but yeah, it's time. Now I have to like actually make the big effort to, like, instead of going out and like having to get a job, like the chore that you like dread, now I have the chore of having to go out and like find a life, find friends, maybe date someone. I don't know. I don't want to even think about that. I'm watching too much true crime stuff, and it's like, I'll just get murdered. Someone will fall in love with me, and they'll be, and of course, you know, they'll become obsessed, and then they won't be able to leave me alone, and you know how it is. You know how it is. You know how it is. We've all been stalked at one time or another. Yeah, I just worry about that sort of thing. So right now, I just want to focus on this. Keep making it better. Try not to take too many days off in a row on, you know, at times like these. I'm really liking the solutions I'm seeing here. Yeah, so at this point, I ought to get back to bed. I was towards my bed because yeah, I've been definitely feeling the need. Look what I sliced, printed. If you watched my live stream the other day, you got to see that getting printed. And the final one, I don't know if I don't think I even took a picture of it. It's too bad, but I am going to do another anyway. But I sent it off. I put it in a box. I'm going to be sending it off soon. Anyway, one last comment about computer science before I run, I guess. Just thinking. I can just connect it to everything. I mean, for me, it's something it was the first. It was something. It was my destiny. I was, I have to say, it was my destiny to get into this weird niche. Even if I don't know if it was my destiny to end up like sitting in the bedroom coding, you know, like that would be my thing. But it started out that way, and I saw a lot of foreshadowing early in my life that this was kind of, you know, where I needed to be or what I needed to do, that I was where I was happiest, so to speak. I'm happiest when I'm working, when I have something to work on that's interesting, that consumes my time, and that gives people joy as well. Like, you know, when I show off what I've done, like people, yay, good, you know. Marlin gives me some opportunity for that, and I have to feel like, and lately I've been feeling a little bit hard pressed to find ways to get more of that stuff in there into it that makes that impression, that really makes people happy. There's stuff that I need to do to make myself happy, cleaning up the code. But yeah, like this, so anyway, tying it all together, destiny, happiness, all that sort of thing. So yeah, I guess in a way it took me a long time, but the thing was I had to accept that I wasn't there. It was a long time well, initially in my upbringing, it was like I was brought up with this, with the just as the chatter was, you know, okay, son, gonna have to learn to, like, you know, deal. So here's, go get a shitty job, and then you'll just have to deal with getting another shitty job. And that's life, man. You're just gonna go from one shitty job to the next shitty job. And, you know, just learn to deal with bosses and all those kinds of, and managers and customers, you know, all the things that you're supposed to learn. And, like, you know, I know that some of those lessons, I think a lot of those lessons were there just to, like, train me out of wanting to do any of that kind of stuff. But, I mean, early on, it was, like, obvious to me. I could not, you know, take the retail job or whatever, but I hated it, you know. And at least I had, like, a job at a record store. I could get a discount on records and be exposed to new music and stuff. Meet people really easy, you know, and have a really kind of a fun time with that. But, you know, those things only go so far. I mean, it's a job. Social life. It's a gateway. But you have your real interest, you know, and you want to hopefully bring these things together in some manner, find some balance. So that's what I'm hopefully have found at this point, is, you know, I think the hardest part is, like, now is that I overindulge. It's like I really just want to do this, like, all the time and not be bothered. Like, I just want to dive into the problem solving, figure stuff out, and get on to stuff. And so the hard part for me is now the fact that I am a project manager, and I have to accept that there is management to be done. So there's daily tasks, and then also there's the Discord and the Facebook and the other things that I'm participating in, discussions elsewhere with other companies and people and so forth. And it, just balancing it all is like, now I have to, like, okay, take a deep breath and sort of, like, stop being so damn excited about it and trying to, like, you know, treat it like my own personal playground as so much, and sort of like, all right, slog through the slog, and then there'll be more time to, like, play in the playground. So this week I'm slogging through the slog more to get through the bugs that need to be dealt with. And as Saturday arrives and Sunday appears to be on the horizon, I hope I'll be able to tag a new release, just to give people a little more confidence that there are some bug patches have been applied and there's something that's been certified bug patched slightly better. And I have been meaning to do these about every 2 weeks. And, you know, this long hiatus between December and June was just, like, it was really just due to, like, paranoia over certain bugs that I was like, when are we ever going to figure those out? At least we got today. We saw that we had the arc issue is now sorted. The Z probe fade issue was sorted last week or a couple weeks ago, and other issues have gotten sorted as well. And some of those are in the release. More of them will be coming in, but yeah, like, we're solving a lot of problems. So hopefully, again, the next thing in my little computer science world will be to try and maintain my enthusiasm, or at least not get overwhelmed with everything that needs to be done. The thing is that, you know, it comes in at a fast pace, and it can get overwhelming. It can seem to pile up, but there is no ultimate timeline. There's no deadline. That makes it weird. Any stress that I feel about needing to get something done is really myself. Part of that is that there are things that I want to get to that I feel like, oh, well, I've got this other pile over here. I should really take care of the pile first before I get to it. And then when those things conflict with each other, it can be hard to focus on anything. So it's like finding the balance and finding a way to get through stuff is become like the next thing. So, you know, from the topic of computer science, I guess the next thing I have to get into is, like, how do you, now that you've mastered and become the great computer scientist you always wanted to become, got the project you always wanted and you've got the perfect life, how do you, like, not drop the ball and, like, go, and, you know, you can't just sigh and be like, well, I'm here, I made it, and go off, like, you know, there's still the work to be done every day. So how do you manage that? That's what we'll be learning here on this live stream as we go forward. And part of why I am doing these live streams is just to basically keep a sort of a record, get a little more comfortable in front of the camera, and just basically keep people more in the loop with what I'm doing. Even though these are hours and hours long, I figure, well, hey, you know, like Jonathan Blow is totally boring us with his game engine streams of extreme length and discussing whatever it is he's discussing on those. So be it. Here we are. I may spend more time over on the YouTube, because if only because no one ever shows up to these things on Twitch. I feel like it's just maybe not the place for these kinds of streams. Also, I do want to talk more to my my patrons and people who kind of like frequent this whole world of rep rap. And one thing is that we know is that they are all over YouTube, and everybody has a Google account, and everybody is subscribed to Joel and Chris and everybody else and Brian. Angus, and you name them. You name them, we subscribe to them. So anywho, it being 4:40 a.m., that's a perfect day. So I'm going to take off and, I don't know, probably not sleep. Probably just watch some videos, but until I sleep. But I can't do this anymore. This has been fun, though. I got through this, and I'm going to merge all these fun pull requests tomorrow. Oops. Look at that. There's an issue right there. 2 days ago, 5 days ago. Yeah, so I am going to get through at least. Took too much time off. So, but today also, I also got a grocery order in, so. That always makes me happier, like I can actually focus more because I don't have to, like, you know, and it's like I forget to eat if I don't have it like at hand. I'm like, oh, I gotta go eat, I won't bother. Do I have any popcorn? I'll just have some of that. So in your career as a computer scientist, I would say definitely have a smoothie, you know, make sure to take care of your health. Certainly would recommend everybody to stop eating any animals products and stuff like that, because it messes with you. But, you know, it's a flavor sensation. But honestly, the truth is that those flavors are not that unique or special. The flavors of chicken and the flavors of turkey and the flavors of bacon. It's true. I have a recipe for a tempeh bacon that I do that's just like indistinguishable from your pork bacon, but at the same time like totally like healthy and good. As a computer scientist, I highly recommend investigating ways to improve the data acquisition of your cells, and veganism is one way. Or vegetarianism, whatever you prefer. It's one way to make your cells happier. Doctor, I'm kind of jonesing for a green smoothie, but I don't want to run the blender. Silent blender, next thing to make. All right, let's go work on that. Talk to you guys soon.